The second chapter is about elasticity. This slide shows the contents of this chapter. The first section is mathematical and physical background. The second is strain. The third is stress. Fourth is the generalized Hooke's law. Fifth is the elastic moduli of symmetric and isotropic materials. The sixth is a frequently used elastic constants of isotropic materials. Seventh is the averaged elasticity of composite solids. Eighth is elastic wave velocity. Ninth is acoustic impedance. Then the section one, mathematical and physical backgrounds. This slide shows the contents of the section 2.1. The first is the characteristic values and vectors of linear transformation. The matrix A and the vector X is equal to the product of the scalar lambda and the vector X, equation 2.1.1. A linear transformation in an n-dimensional space has n pairs of characteristic vectors and values. Namely, this relation can be expressed by the product of the matrix A and the vector x1 is equal to a scalar lambda 1 times the vector x1. And blah blah blah, the matrix A, the product of matrix A and the vector xn is equal to the product of the scalar n lambda n and vector xn, equation 2.1.2. The equation 2.1.2 can be expressed using the diagonal matrix lambda, which is lambda 1, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, lambda 1, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, lambda 3, 0, 0, 0, 0, blah, 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 0, 0, 0, 0, blah, 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 lambda n. And the matrix X, which is the array of vector x1, x2, blah, 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 x2, xn. Then, the equation 2.1.2 can be written, the product of matrix A and matrix X is equal to the product of the matrix X and matrix lambda. Then this equation can be written as the inverse matrix of X and matrix A and matrix X is equal to matrix lambda. So this procedure is referred to as diagonalization, equation 2.1.3. Let us consider one example of diagonalization. We consider the matrix 1, 2, minus 1, 4. The eigenvector values of this matrix is 2 and 3, and the eigenvectors of this matrix is x1 equal 2, 1, and x2 is 1, 1. Then the diagonal matrix of lambda is 2003, the array matrix X is equal to 2111, and the inverse of the matrix X equal 1 minus 1 1 minus 1 2. Then the product of inverse X matrix A and the matrix X is equal to minus 1 minus 1 minus 1 2 times 1 2 minus 1 4 times 2 1 1 1. Then it becomes 1 minus 1 minus 1 2 4 3 2 3. Then it becomes 2 0 0 3. Then it is equal to the diagonal matrix lambda. Next, let us define transpose matrix AT, which is a matrix whose components are flipped from the orthogonal matrix A over the diagonal. Namely, the transposed matrix of ABCD is ACBD. Equation 2.1.4. It is also written the component IJ of the transposed matrix A is equal to the component JI of the matrix A. Also, we can use the same notation for the vectors. Transformation from the horizontal vector to the vertical vector is expressed using the transposed vector. Transpose vector of the horizontal vector AB is equal to the vertical vector AB, and vice versa. Then next, we define symmetric matrix, namely, for example, ABBC. It is clear that the transposed matrix of matrix A is equal to the original matrix A. The component Aij is equal to Aji. I don't prove that an important theorem is the characteristic vectors of the symmetric matrix are orthogonal to each other. Namely, the each characteristic vectors are perpendicular to each other. Equation 2.1.6. Then the next is a complex number and a function. The complex number can be expressed by a plus bi. I is the square root of minus 1, referred to as imaginary unit. And the real part, A is called the real part of the complex number Z, and B is referred to as the imaginary part of the complex number Z. We plot the complex number in the so-called Argand diagram like this. In this diagram, the horizontal axis is the real part and the vertical axis is for imaginary part. Therefore, the complex number A plus BI is expressed by this point whose horizontal component is A and whose vertical component is B. We define a complex conjugate. Let us consider the imaginary number z, which is equal to x plus iy. The complex conjugate of z, z asterisk, is equal to x minus iy. Let us define modulus, or absolute value or magnitude of the complex number z, which is expressed using R equal the absolute value of Z, and which is defined as square root of X squared plus Y squared. This is a distance from the orthogonal point. Namely, if we consider the complex number X and which is equal to x plus iy, the modulus r is the distance between from the original point O to the this point z in the Argand diagram. We define the polar notation. Z is expressed using the modulus r plus cosine phi and I sine phi. Cosine phi is angle, this one, and cosine phi is the ratio of the modulus, ratio of the real component x relative to the modulus x. And the sine phi is the ratio of the y to r. The angle phi is referred to argument. This is the angle of the OZ with the real axis. The complex conjugate of z is equal to r times cosine phi minus I sine phi, which is equal to r times cosine minus phi plus phi I sine minus phi, equation 2.1.11. Let us define some function of a complex number. The first one is complex exponential function. The exponential function of I theta plus minus I theta is equal is defined as cosine theta plus minus I sine theta, equation 2.1.12. The exponential of phi plus minus I theta, here phi is a real number, then it is equal to e phi times cosine theta plus minus I sine theta, equation 2.1.13. This relation is clear from the properties of the complex complex function. The conjugate of the exponential function I theta is equal to cosine theta minus I sine theta, therefore equal to exponential function of minus I theta, equation 2.1.14. The modulus of exponential function of I theta is defined as square root of cosine theta squared plus sine theta squared, therefore it is unity, 2.1.15. The complex exponential function satisfies the basic property of the exponential functions, namely exponential function of A times exponential function of B is equal to the exponential function of A plus B. Let us prove this relation. The exponential function of I alpha times the exponential function of I beta is equal to cosine alpha plus I cosine alpha times cosine beta times I cosine beta. Then it becomes cosine alpha times cosine beta minus sine alpha times sine beta plus I times sine alpha cosine beta plus cosine alpha sine beta. Then because of the relations of the trigonal functions, the real part is cosine alpha plus beta and the imaginary part is sine alpha plus beta. Therefore, this formula is equal to the exponential function of I alpha plus beta, equation 2.1.16. Let us obtain the relations between the complex exponential function and real trigonometric functions. As we have already seen, the exponential function of ix is equal to cosine x plus I sine x. The complex function or exponential function of minus ix is equal to cosine x minus I sine x. Therefore, by adding these two formulas, the cosine x is equal to exponential function of ix plus exponential function minus ix divided by 2, equation 2.1.17. And sin x is equal to exponential function of ix minus exponential function of minus ix divided by 2, equation 2.1.18. As we will see later, the complex exponential function, exponential of I 2 pi over t x equal cosine 2 pi over t x plus I sine 2 pi over t x, is more convenient to express an oscillation than the real trigonometric function, because it contains the trigonometric functions, and the calculation is easy because of the these relations of the exponential function. You can realize it later. Then next is a simple differential equation. The differential equation that we will encounter in this chapter is the second derivative of function psi x is equal to minus a squared times function psi, equation 2.1.19. This is an equation of the harmonic oscillators. The solution of 2.1.19 is psi equal c constant times exponential function of plus minus I ax. Let us confirm this solution. The second derivative of the function c e plus minus iax is equal to first derivative of plus minus ia times c e plus minus iax, and which is equal to plus minus ia squared times c plus minus iax, then equal to minus a squared times c e I plus minus iax, then equal to minus a squared y. So the equation 2.1.20 is a solution of equation 2.1.19. Next is the one-dimensional wave function. This slide shows the variables to express waves. V is phase velocity, T is period, F is inverse of the period, namely frequency. Omega is 2 pi times frequency, namely and the frequency. Lambda is wavelength. Mu tilde is inverse of wavelength, namely the wave number. K is 2 pi times mu tilde, namely the angular wave number. And A is amplitude. This diagram shows the relations among different variables. Horizontally connected variables is relations between linear frequency and angular frequency. So these two are factor 2 pi different. And vertical axis, vertical direction express the inverse relation. So linear frequency is inverse of linear period, and linear wave number is inverse of linear wavelength. And the relations in the depth range direction is the time and length. So for example, length of the time is period, and length of the distance is wavelength, and so on. I don't know we call, for example, angular period, but theoretically it should be called angular period. Then wave. What is a wave? The wave is such that a medium oscillates periodically at each point, and that the peaks and nodes shift with time at a constant rate. In other words, the medium oscillates both spatially and timely. This diagram expresses waves. At a given time, the medium shows sinusoidal shape. From top to the bottom, the time increases from t equals 0, t equals 0.3, t equals 0.6, t equals 0.9, t equals 1.2, and t equals 1.5. As you can see, the wave shifts from left to right. If you focus on this peak shift moves to left to from left to the right. If you focus on this point first go down and then go up. Therefore, the wave function can be written as a product of two complex functions. One is with a position x, and one is with time t. The argument of one exponential function is I times 2 pi over the wavelength lambda times position x, and the other exponential function is over plus minus I times 2 pi over the period t times time t, equation 2.1.21. This wave function can be written as A amplitude times exponential function of I 2 pi the linear wave number nu tilde x times exponential function of plus minus I 2 pi linear frequency f t 2.1.21. And it also can be written the amplitude A times exponential function of I times the angular wave number k times position x times exponential function of plus minus I the angular frequency omega times the time t equation 2.1.21 double prime. And it can be written 8 the amplitude times exponential function of I times kx plus minus omega t equation 2.1.21. If kx minus omega t, the waves propagate in the positive direction. If the kx plus, if this is plus, the wave propagates in the negative direction. Using the phase velocity nu, v equal the product of the frequency f times the amplitude lambda, the period lambda equal the angular frequency omega over the angular wave number k. The wave function y x t is equal to the amplitude a times exponential function of I k x plus minus v t equation 2.1.24. This partial differential equation is referred to as the wave equation. Namely, the second partial derivative of function y with respect to time is equal to the phase velocity v squared times the second partial derivative of y function y with respect to x. The wave function yxy equal a times exponential function of I the wave number k, the angular wave number k position x times exponential function of plus minus I partial the angular frequency of omega times the time t is the solution of the wave equation 2.1.25. Let us demonstrate this fact. The second partial derivative of the wave function y with respect to time is equal to the wave the partial derivative with respect to time of the partial derivative of with respect to time of the amplitude a times exponential function of ikx times exponential function of plus minus I omega t. Then it is equal to the partial derivative of with respect to time of minus I omega e exponential function of ikx times exponential function of minus plus minus ik I omega t equal minus omega squared a exponential function of ikx times exponential function of minus ik plus minus I omega t equal minus omega squared times the wave function y. The right side is v squared times the second partial derivative of the wave function y with respect to position x is equal to the velocity, phase velocity v squared times minus k squared a exponential function of ikx times exponential function of I omega t is equal to minus omega over k squared times k squared y equal minus omega squared y wave function. Thus the left side is equal to right. Therefore the equation 1.21 y equal a exponential function of ikx times exponential function plus minus I omega t is the solution of the wave equation 2.1.25. Next is vector operators. Let us consider the vector A, which is a three-dimensional vector with components of A1, A2, A3. Then next, the scalar B. Let us consider the scalar B, which is a function position coordinates x1, x2, x3. The vector A is also the function position coordinates x1, x2, x3. Then we define the operator nabla. Nabla is defined as the partial derivative with respect to x1, the partial derivative with respect to x2, and the partial derivative with respect to x3, equation 2.1.26. Then we define gradient. Gradient is the operator nabla on the scalar B. Therefore, it is identical to the partial derivative of B with respect to x1, partial derivative of B with respect to x2, the partial derivative of B with respect to x3. Thus, B is scalar, but the nabla B or a gradient B is the vector. Next is divergence. Divergence is the operator to the vector A. Informality, which is the inner product of the nabla and the vector A, which is identical to the partial derivative of A1 with respect to x1 plus the partial derivative of A2 with respect to x2 plus the partial derivative of x3 with respect to partial derivative of A3 with respect to x3, equation 2.1.28. Thus, the A is the vector, but divergence A is scalar. Next is the rotation. Rotation vector A is also as a formality, the outer product of the nabla and the vector A. Therefore, it is identical to the partial derivative of A3 with respect to x2 minus partial derivative of A2 with respect to x3, partial derivative of A1 with respect to x3 minus partial derivative of x3 with respect to x1, partial derivative of A2 with respect to x1 minus partial derivative of A1 with respect to x3, equation 2.1.29. So in the case of rotation, A is a vector, and also rotation A is also a vector. Finally, Laplacian. The Laplacian is expressed as the squared number on the scalar B, or inner product of the nabla and gradient B. Namely, it is identical to the second derivative of B with respect to x1 plus the second derivative of B with respect to x2 plus second derivative of B with respect to x3, equation 2.1.30. Thus, the B is scalar, and the Laplacian B is also scalar. Then last one is a plane wave in three-dimensional space. Before talking about the equation of the three-dimensional wave, please let me introduce the directional cosine. Let us consider the vector v, whose component is v1, v2, and v3. By using the standard basis vectors in Cartesian notation, e1, e1, e2, e2, e3, e3, the vector v is expressed as v1 times the vector e1 plus v2 times e2 plus v3 times e3, equation 2.1.31. The angle that the v forms e1, e2, e3 are expressed by alpha, beta, gamma. Then the cosine alpha is equal to the vector e1 times the inner product of e1 and v divided by the modulus of v, which is equal to v1 over square root of v1 squared plus v2 squared plus v3 squared, equation 2132a. Similarly, cosine beta is equal to e2, the inner product of e2 and v divided by the modulus of v, which is equal to v2 over the square root of v1 squared plus v2 squared plus v3 squared, equation 2132b. Similarly, the cosine gamma is equal to v3 over square root of v1 squared plus v2 squared plus v3 squared, equation 2132c. Therefore, the vector v can be expressed using the modulus of the v times vector whose component is cosine alpha, cosine beta, cosine gamma, equation 2133. The vector a, whose components are cosine alpha, cosine beta, cosine gamma, is referred to as the directional cosine. Obviously, the square of cosine alpha plus square of cosine beta and square of cosine gamma equal unity. Equation 2134. Then let us consider a plane wave that propagates in the direction of the directional cosine A, whose component is A1, A2, A3, namely cosine alpha, cosine beta, cosine gamma. The equation of the wave surface is expressed by the vector x, whose component is x sub 1, x sub 2, x sub 3. Therefore, the inner product of the directional cosine A and the point x is constant, namely distances are constant. By using the components a sub 1 times a sub x sub 1 plus a sub 2 times x sub 2 plus a sub 3 x sub 3 is constant, then the displacement of the of u on the wave surface propagating with the speed v is expressed by the function f, and whose argument is the inner product of the directional vector a times the position vector x minus vt. Equation 2137. If the wave is sinusoidal, the function of the displacement vector u equal f the inner product of the directional cosine a and the position x minus vt can be expressed using the complex exponential function, namely the displacement vector u is equal to the amplitude vector a times the exponential function of the imaginary unit I times the wave vector k times the inner product of the directional cosine a and the position x minus vt. Equation 2.1.38 from the one-dimensional wave function yxt is equal to the amplitude a times exponential function of ikx minus vt. Therefore, the wave the displacement u is equal to the amplitude vector a times exponential function of ik a sub 1 x sub 1 plus a sub 2 times x sub 2 plus a sub 3 times x sub 3 minus vt. If the wave propagate in the xi direction, the directional cosine in the other direction should are zero. Therefore, the equation 2.1.38 becomes the displacement vector u is equal to the amplitude vector a times the exponential function of I times the wave vector wave number k times the directional cosine in a direction a sub I times the position position xi x sub y minus kvt, and the k times the wave number k times the directional cosine a sub y is expressed using k sub I, then the this function become the amplitude vector a times exponential function of I times k sub y times x sub y minus omega t. Therefore, using the vector k, whose component is k sub 1, k sub 2, k sub 3, and each of them is the wave number k times the directional cosine in one direction, and k times a sub 2 and k times a sub 3. Then the displacement vector u is equal to the amplitude vector a times exponential function of I times the imaginary number I times k sub 1 times x sub 1 plus k sub 2 times x sub 2 plus k sub 3 times x sub 3 minus omega t, and therefore is equal to the amplitude vector a times exponential function of the imaginary number a times the inner product of the wave vector k and the position x minus omega t. Equation 2.1.39. Let us consider the multidimensional wave using the two-dimensional plane wave as an example. So in this is this figure explain the two-dimensional wave. So red dot lines denote the wave front. The wave vector k is 6 pi 4 pi, this one. Then directional cosine of this wave vector is 33.7 degrees in x1 direction and 56.3 degrees in x2 direction. Then the linear wave number is 3. This means in the x1 direction, there are 3 waves in the unit length. In the x2 direction, the linear wave number is 2. Therefore, there are 2 waves in the unit length. Then, as we can see, the wave propagate in the direction with a larger wave number. Then, in the same way, we differentiate df and df d chi once again. Then we have squared velocity v times the second differential of function f with respect to chi, equation 2140. Similarly, we have a second partial derivative of xi with respect to x1. And because the partial differential of a xi with respect to x1 equals a sub 1, therefore, the second partial derivative of xi with respect to x1 is a1 squared times the second derivative of f with respect to chi, equation 2141a. Similarly, second partial derivative of xi with respect to x2 is equal to a2 squared times the second derivative of f with respect to chi, equation 2.1.41b. And the second derivative of xi with respect to x3 is equal to a3 squared times the second derivative of f with respect to chi, equation 2141c. Then we add three partial differential of xi with respect to the position x1, x2, x3. Then we have x1 squared times the second derivative of f with respect to chi plus a2 squared times second derivative of f with respect to chi plus second a3 squared times second derivative of f with respect to chi. So these three red parts are identical. Therefore, we have a1 squared plus a2 squared plus a3 squared times the second derivative of f with respect to chi. And a1 squared plus a2 squared plus a3 squared is unity because the vector a equal a1, a2, a3 is a directional cosine. Therefore, the sum of the second partial derivative of xi with respect to the position is the second derivative of function f with respect to chi, equation 2.1.42. Then squared velocity times sum of the second partial derivative of xi with respect to the position x1, x2, x3 is equal to second partial velocity squared times second parsh second derivative of f with respect to x2. And we have already seen this is equal to the second partial derivative of c with respect to time, equation 2.1.43. Therefore, second partial derivative of xi with respect to time is equal to velocity squared times the Laplacian of xi, equation 2.1.44. This is the three-dimensional wave equation. Then this is the end of the chapter to elasticity, section 1, mathematical and physical backgrounds.